This unit of recovery techniques. Now we will start with object-oriented database management system. As it is clear from the name that this TBMS use object-oriented concepts. And in previous methods, we have learned of RDBMS, that is relational database management concepts. We also learned about various models like ER models, network model, hierarchical model, but we had implemented RDBMS, that is relational database management system model. But here we'll study object-oriented data model. It is using the same concept that you have studied in C++ or Java, where we create objects for doing programming on real-world entities. But before that, we need to create a class, where class contains attributes of similar kinds, like birds are having similar attributes, humans have similar attributes, furniture has similar attributes, or there can be a color class which are having similar attributes, or shape where its different objects can be triangle, rectangle, square, etc. So these come under classes, and we create objects of those classes. Objects are also called instances. So we'll study this concept in detail. Firstly, we need to study what is object-oriented data model. A data model is a logic organization of the real-world objects. It is also called entities, which are having constraints on them and a relationship among objects. In OOPS, that is object-oriented programming structure, there is the concept of objects and classes, but no constraint and relationships. But in object-oriented database management system or data model, there is also constraints and relationships. Because in RDBMS, we also study different kinds of constraints like foreign key, primary key, differential integrity constraint, like that. But in programming structure, no constraints are being used. But here we use constraints also, and relationship among objects also, like one-to-one, one-to-many, many-to-many, etc. A DB language is a concrete syntax for a data model. So a special language is also used to implement this data model, that is called ODL, that is Object Data Language, or OQL, Object Query Language, and SQL3 also. A DB system implements a data model. A core object-oriented data model consists of following basic object-oriented concepts. The first one is object and object identifier. Object and object identifier. Any real-world entity is uniformly modeled as an object. That we have studied in object-oriented programming structure as well. But it is associated with a unique ID used to pinpoint an object to retrieve. System automatically provides an object ID to every object which we create in the object-oriented TBMS. Now next is attributes and methods. Every object has a state, the set of values for the attributes of the object, and behavior, the set of methods, program code, which operate on the state of the object. Likewise, in object-oriented class, there are different kinds of attributes and methods who work on those attributes. The state and behavior encapsulated in an object are accessed or invoked from outside the object only through explicit message passing. Like we create object of certain class, and we call using dot operator, the method, and then method invokes the particular attribute. An attribute is an instance value, instance variable, whose domain may be any class, user defined or primitive. A class composition, hierarchy, aggregation, relationship is orthogonal to the concept of class hierarchy. The link in a class composition hierarchy may form cycles. We'll study these things in detail in next slides. Now, what is a class? A means of grouping all the objects which share same set of attributes and methods. I already told you, class contains those objects or those attributes for those objects, those attributes which share same properties, same attributes, same features, they come under one class. An object must belong to only one class as an instance of that class. We also call object as an instance. A class is similar to an abstract data type. A class may also be primitive. A class which is having no attribute is called a primitive class. For example, integer string boolean. If we use direct data types rather than creating user-defined data type, that is class, we call it a primitive class. If we use basic data types like integer, string, boolean, etc., bool, in C or C++, then we call it as a primitive class. Now, what is class hierarchy and inheritance? In the object-oriented data model, the most prominent feature of OOPs, that is inheritance or reusability, is also used. That means derive a new class or subclass from an existing superclass, where in C++ we call them as base class and derived class. We can also call them subclass and superclass, where derived class is called subclass and parent class or base class is called superclass. The subclass inherits all the attributes and methods of the existing class and may have additional attributes and methods. Single inheritance, that is class hierarchy, versus multiple inheritance, class lattice. So in single inheritance class, that is called class hierarchy, and multiple inheritance called class lattice. Encapsulation is also the property of object-oriented data model. Now, I'll show you the basic schema of objects. Like in relational DBMS, we call them a relational schema. Here we call object schema. Object schema, the graphical representation. See, this is an object, person. Sorry, this is a class, person, which are having different instance variables. Name, address. This is a class which are having different attributes. Name, address, date of birth, gender, and age. And these are their data types mentioned over here. And these are object instances. That means this is a class. There are various objects created for this class, where name is John, address 123 Main Street, DOB 23rd November, gender male, and age 30. Where these are the data types and these are various object instances of this class person. Now, state of a person object instance. See, this is called instance variables. Don't confuse instance variable as an object. These are the attribute of the class person, where OID, person OID, is the object identifier generated by the system, which is given by the system x to 0. Fine. Now, these three attributes can be further divided into name, address, and DOB can be further divided into various fields. That is, they are called abstract data types. They are giving the overview, but they are having more attributes associated with them, such as name can have three more attributes: first name, middle name, and last name. Address can have more attributes like street number, street, apartment, city, state, zip code. And date of birth can have different attributes like day, month, and year. So these three are abstract data types, ADTs, which are having more attributes associated with them. Object representation for instances of the class person with ADTs. So this is a class person, and these are its attributes, where name, address, date of birth are abstract data types, where sex and age are basic data types. Object schemas, the graphical representation of objects. See, graphically it can be represented as, this is a class with object identifier x20. So for name, it is further divided into x201, which is having three attributes: first name, last name, middle name, and last name. Fine. And for address, it can be further divided into five or six attributes: street number, street, apartment, city, state, and zip code. And then similarly, date of birth can be further divided into three attributes: day, month, and year, where gender and age are basic data types and they are having direct values. The object space or object schema is the equivalent of a database schema or a relational schema at a given time. Both are equal in RDBMS, all of these things are represented in terms of relations, that is tables. But here, all these things are represented in terms of classes and objects, where some of the attributes of the class can be ADTs, that is abstract data types, having further attributes. Now, referential sharing of objects. So, see what is this? This is the class person with object ID X20. That means one of its object is having identity X20, and these are its attributes. So this is name attribute X201. This is another object X2. This is another expansion, that is address OID X202. See, it is X201. So for name, we are giving additional one over here. For address, we are giving 2. And for third abstract data type, we are appending 203. Fine. Suppose these are other objects of the same class person, that is 1029. This is person OID X26. Here it is X20. Here, this is another person OID 26. See, this person, this object X26, and this object X20 and X26 share the same address. See, address is connected over here. You can see from this diagram. That means two objects, two persons are having the same address for this object model, because there can be entry of two students, suppose they are siblings, into the database, and both are sharing the same address. They are having different IDs, X20, X26, but they are having similar address. So in database, they can be connected like this. Rather than making its new entry, we can connect them so that they can share the same attribute value of address. Now, object schemas, the graphical representation of objects. Now, here I'll tell you what is superclass and subclass relationship. See, person is a superclass, which is further categorized into two classes, employee and student, where these both are subclasses. Employee object representation, it is having these attributes, where this is social security number. These are other attributes: name, address, DOB, sex, age, and salary. Now, inter-object relationship, attribute class link. An attribute class or inter-object relationship is created when object's attribute references another object of the same or different class. Now we'll study different kinds of relationships: one to many, many to many, many to one, etc. See the hierarchy. This is root class. It is further divided into various classes like manufacturer, item, person, facility. A person can be further divided into employee class, where employees can be of different kinds: manager, clerk, secretary, cashier, and stocker. And facility means what facility is company providing: warehouse and store. It is having two fronts, where employees can work at warehouse as well as in store. So this is categorization of classes in hierarchical form. Now we'll understand object schemas, the graphical represent. Before that, I want to tell you one thing. If employee class is having these attributes, social security, name, address, these are the attributes exhibited by the base class. So they can also be inherited by manager, clerk, secretary, cashier, and stocker. These are the basic attributes which can be shared by all of these employees. Now we'll understand what are the relationships. Related classes are enclosed in boxes to make relationships more noticeable. There are three points for depicting or representing the relationships. I'll explain you all these three points with examples. Related classes are enclosed in boxes to make relationships more noticeable. Here we'll make boxes around the classes for which we have to show the relationship. The double line on the box right side indicates that the relationship is mandatory. If there are two lines in the box, that means that is a mandatory relationship. Connectivity is indicated by labeling each box. We'll also mention the name of the class inside the box to show the connectivity. Now we'll understand this through graphical example. first of all, one-to-many relationship. See, this is employee class, this is facility class. In the previous figure, we have already studied what is facility, warehouse or store. So here we can understand that one employee can work, in more than one facility. See here, facility is mentioned inside a block box, and here employee is mentioned inside a box. We have to mention here the class name, not the attribute name. See, facility is a class name and employee is also a class name. So this is one to many relationship. That is, an employee should be working in one facility, either in warehouse or in store, or many employees can work in one facility. So this is one to many relationship. See, this box represent mandatory participation, and 1, M connectivity. This number is representing 1M, that is, this is 1-to-M connectivity. Employee will be working in any of the one facility, that is either warehouse or store, and in one facility, many employees can work. So this is 1-to-many relationship. Now next, we'll understand what is 1-to-1 and 1-to-many relationships. See, this is employee class and this is facility. Facility can be either warehouse or store. These are the attributes of employee. These are the attributes of facility. Now, works at facility 1, where manager employee. That means one to many. This is similar to the previous case. One employee will work in one facility, and it can have, one facility can have multiple employees. And see over here, manager of facility 1 and manager employee 1, where each facility will have one manager and one employee can be a manager of one facility. So this is 1-to-1 relationship. One employee can act as manager. So here it is written as one employee can act as manager of one facility, and one facility can have one manager. So this is 1-to-1 relationship. And this is a previous case we have already discussed in the previous slide. That is, one employee will be working at one facility, and one facility can have multiple employees. Employee dependent relationship. This is M-to-1, that is many-to-one relationship. You should understand this concept. Employee dependent. These are two classes. These are the attributes of employee and these are the attributes of dependent. So one employee can have multiple dependents. So here we have written M, and one dependent is associated with one employee. So here it is one. Dependent means mother, father, kids, etc. These are called dependent of the employee. So one employee can have multiple dependents. Like for a male employee, there can be dependent his mother, father, kids, and wife. And dependent can have one dependent is associated with one employee. So this is many to one relationship. Now the next is representing M-to-N relationship, that is many to many relationship. So these are two classes, manufacturer and item. These are the attributes of manufacturer and these are the attributes of item. See over here, one manufacturer can manufacture many items. So here it is written M, and one item can be manufactured by many manufacturers. So for manufacturer class, there is also written M. So this is many to many relationships. You can also write here N as well. Otherwise M to M is also fine. One manufacturer can produce many items and one item can be produced by many manufacturers. So this is many to many relationship. So up to this point, we have learned about what is object-oriented database management system. What are its basic constructs? It shares the same properties as that of object-oriented programming structure. And we have discussed about various kinds of relationships in object-oriented database model. In the next lecture, we'll discuss next topic of this OODBMS. Thank you.